All right. Well, let me turn the volume down first. Let's turn the music down a bit. Welcome to Treasure Pests. I'll turn that up a little bit more. So this is the year 3 production module game that I have mostly finished. No, it was alright actually. It was pretty good. Being able to use assets that were already available helped a lot, as I am no artist or animator. So, quick background for this. The inspiration for it, it was Clank, the board game. In Clank, you delve into a dungeon, collecting treasure and avoiding a dragon. And the more noise you make, the more likely it is that the dragon will defeat you. Now, Clank itself is a deck building game, and the points are in your deck for doing it. And as you collect more things and as you refine your deck, get rid of the bad cards, you keep the good cards, you get more points at the end if you make it out alive. And once you pick up a big artifact, one of the big treasures there, you have only a couple of turns before the dragon just kills everyone left in the dungeon. That's the general premise, and the general premise also used for this game, in which you go into a dungeon collecting treasure and picking up a major artifact which acts as a multiplier for the points, and then you got to get out before you die, just like that. When I first started doing this, although I had the general premise, it helped I already had all the dungeon stuff as well, all the assets. But I was torn between doing an isometric game and a third person game, so a third person dungeon crawler. Ended up going for isometric for multiple different reasons. You could hide more because the camera's fixed, so you don't have to worry too much about it. I don't think I ever used that fixed perspective to hide anything, but the option was there. Because it was further away, things like combat and like smaller effects didn't have to be as good, so to speak. But there is no combat in this game, so that also didn't matter too much. The initial premise was just to be an adventurer going in. That, after some talking and after looking at assets, that ended up getting scrapped for basically you control the goblin, this guy on your left, and they're basically just pests, as you see, they're just an infestation of like mice and rats. That was the basic the vibe that was going for. So everything's generally a bit bigger than it would normally be for a human-sized adventurer, for example, and you were just going around collecting things, and everything was sort of just from the perspective of the goblins. The entire dungeon is procedurally generated, as we will have a look. So the UI obviously is not the art itself is from the internet as well. The loading screen uses the async plugin, so it's an actual loading screen. It doesn't stop until the game's actually loaded. So it's not just a widget over the top. So here we are. This is the home island of the goblins. You can talk to these people. They have random emojis. This guy's just drunk. There's one here. So I went for the Facebook YouTube game approach of just using emojis. Some awesome sounds. So a quick hint, all the entrance teleporters, the beginning teleporters I should say, have the trees. Exit ones don't have trees, so if you're trying to get back, you're looking for the trees basically. So as you can see, you've got you can fall down and die here, be careful. But yeah, it is all procedurally generated. There are traps. You know what? I will open the menu and reduce the sound effects. And that gets saved as well. We've got all the standard stuff. You can have VSync if you want as well. Go for it. So apply, back. It's not as quiet as I thought it was going to be. Let's just reduce the master volume as well. So surprisingly, the sound aspects of this were the second longest thing to do, because I could not get the sliders to work properly, and I could not get it to save the settings and things like that. So the options in general, especially the music, was the second longest thing to do. The longest thing was obviously the dungeon generation. So inspired by how they made Diablo using a gizmo system, which spawns different things like these traps. And there is a system involved that allows that the further you go in, the more enemies that spawn, the more items and the more treasures and things like that. That's currently disabled because it doesn't just use one generator. So one of the things that was happening, that I had to decide on, was how to do the dungeon crawling itself. Whether to go for a floor per level, so it opens up a new level every time. So there's a standard sort of Diablo stuff. Or whether to do something else. Now I wanted... can't really go around this way. I wanted to have traps that teleport you to different locations. It's difficult to do that if you then have to open up the next level and then load it and then have to save that layout and everything else and do all that other stuff. And it was just a malarkey, right? So I decided not to do that. So what's happened is there are four different floors in this one level. And the higher up you go, since it's a floating temple, technically, the higher up you go, the more the multipliers are worth. Generally, all the other points, I was going to try and do a system where the higher up you go, all the points are worth more. But it got messy, so I just scrapped that. But the multipliers do all change. So the higher up you go, the more points you get. Some of the things that the gizmos spawn are things like these mines. These are traps. There occasionally is a bug that the material doesn't spawn properly, so it's an invisible mine. But these do damage to you, so these ones do cold air and slow you down briefly. Well, they should slow you down briefly. It might not be brief enough, or might be too brief. This is an explosion, which does 3 points of damage, so you really want to avoid those. This electrocutes you and stuns you in place. And there's a green one which teleports you. So if you have a look. Yeah, so it slows you down. This one stuns you. The sound plays... Oh, there you go. Look at that. The sound plays a bit longer than you would like. I might have to go back and fix that. Along with that, you've got patrols. So these skeletons, they'll chase you. They use a line of sight plugin. They'll chase you and they'll attack you when you... they should attack you. Ah! You do also flash when you get hit. The AI is not my speciality, unfortunately, so it's a bit finicky. There's also some collision issues with some of the stuff. I'd have to go through and really fine comb it. Some of the difficult things that I had to deal with was getting the teleporting system to work between all the teleporters here. Because normally when you'd reach the end and hit the exit, you would just load the next level and start off in the right place. Fortunately, Dan did help out with connecting all the teleporters correctly. And they all work nice and they don't spawn multiple times, which was a thing that happened. You can see in the top right, there is a percentage based. So that is similar to the Persona games. When you do something, haha. It goes up. Oh, nice. And when it hits 100%, that's when the main boss comes along. So as you saw there, these boxes you can break, and you can also open chests, and you can also unlock doors. Big chests are trapped. You do get a brief warning before a trap happens. I think it might be a little bit too brief, but they're all the same, so it's once you've seen it once, you'll know, right? So as you saw, you've got items there. Now, you can't pick up everything. I mean, you can, technically. But you have the inventory system. So you've got... If I had a bit more time, I would have randomized all the information and everything else. But at the moment, it just randomizes the value and the size as well. And you can drag it, you can rotate them as well. This did take a little while. Fortunately, there's lots of information on YouTube to do it. But it actually worked straight away. Now, you can see the grey bits around the outside. That's because I didn't scale it correctly. So it is actually connected on those places. As you can see the green bit, or the red when it says it can't connect there. It's just that grey outline, the highlight outline. I've flipped one of the things around and it's just not hovering over correctly. So one of those fine comb bugs that we have to fix. But you can actually drag it out as well. So you drop the books and the points do disappear. So the purpose of this, because there's no combat, I wanted you to do something else. So you actually can find loads of treasure, but you've got to decide what you want and what you don't want. So you always want the highest points. Now, obviously, the rarities go up by as standard. So white is common, green is uncommon, blue is rare. Then you've got epic for purple, and legendary is orange. And then you've got artifacts, which are sort of creamy color. Generally speaking, the higher the artifacts, the higher the items, the more points they're worth. But as you can see here, that's not always the case. So you've got to sometimes think, do I want small things that are worth more? Do I want big things? It's just a bit of a... It's the main sort of thing that you got to do. And you've got to avoid all the traps from the enemies. This one there is an multiplier. Artifact is an artifact. So you can pick it up. You've got the multiplier. There's 10. And random descriptions as well. So these are set descriptions for these. And there's seven more. The further you go in, the bigger the multipliers are. They do fit into your thing. And you can only carry one at a time as well. Surprisingly, some of the widgets were finicky to try and put in. And just like in Clank, you pick it up and it'll activate the alarm. So the percentage will reach 100% and you get chased. Let's go explore a bit more first. Now, that's not the only way it goes up to 100%, because as you see, it does go up to 100% regardless. So you've got to be careful anyway. So you've got to go, well, do I want to keep opening things? The chests have bigger multipliers on them as well. So if you go to the bigger the chest, the big ones here. So yeah, there's a slight issue with the collision. My treasure's gone. What the? That's a bit of a bummer. So that sometimes happens. The joys of working with simulate physics, I suppose. Well, you can go to the next one, next island, and you can see down below, you can actually see the stuff happening below. You can see the patrols and everything else. So you can keep going. Well, so these teleport ones are here. Can be a bit finicky. Sometimes it doesn't teleport you correctly. And I love the pop. It's great. And now we're not trapped. We got a way out over here. But I'm not sure where we are now because it can teleport you to four different floors. So you just go along, and that's the general game, I suppose. A lot of the stuff was done surprisingly quickly. Like the randomization of the items and everything else. I didn't have to do any sort of iterations for it. That goes up. We don't want to do that. So I didn't have to do a lot of iterations. It was only really the dungeon generator that took the longest. And then it was just building on top of that and adding more and more stuff. So more items, more treasures and everything else. That is... So we're on floor 2, because there's a 30. So we get chased. And there's the boss. The AI spawning was a bit... We don't want to go that way. Oh, no, maybe we do. No, we don't want to go that way. No! So if you get too far away, he will actually do that. Again, it's a little bit finicky. I like that word. And his speed does gradually increase, so it is inevitable that he will end up catching you. Or it should increase, anyway. That guy's just not walking there, I don't know why. Good God! Yeah, it was some of the hard things. Just make sure everything worked, I suppose. Because if something didn't work, then it was quite difficult to find where that issue was. Yeah, so he's constantly increasing, doing it like a lot. It was this way. I think it was this way. Ah! There's no ground, so he's just flying along. So, yeah, there's a few minor issues. It's fine. Oh, what else is there to say? I don't think anything was super difficult to actually do. I don't think his speed increases enough. But if you stop, then he'll spawn underneath you, so... Hey, there we go. Making it look nice was the most difficult thing, I think. I was looking at the maths there, and I thought the maths was wrong. No, 22 times 30 is 660. Oh. The problem with playing through it now, I'm looking at it going, wait, is that right? Is that wrong? Yeah, it's quite fun. I'm quite happy where it's ended up. Let's go back to the main menu. Just making sure everything worked and everything was sort of moving along correctly. As I said, with the gizmo system, it allowed for more additional things to be placed into it, so you can spawn more stuff. So the traps were a new addition to the base gizmo system that the dungeon uses. But, yeah. I mean, I'm not really sure what I should be talking about, to be honest. A lot of it was just building upon the dungeon generator. Just adding a bit more here and there. And then a lot of the tedious effort of trying to make things look not empty. Which was quite problematic. And that was one of the other issues that were quite troubling. So the biggest problem with working on my own was that if I lost motivation or if something happened outside of the work, there was there's no one else to pick up the slack. So I couldn't rely on anyone else. So I'd lose the days where I didn't do any work, which then causes stress, and then you're thinking about things, and it's just fun and games. But I'd also not have to rely on anyone else to do anything. So I wasn't waiting on other stuff. I wasn't like waiting on art or waiting on systems to be done. So it's a bit of a double-edged sword. But that did happen with the tiles, because there's actually 15 tiles that are randomized. And at first it's like, yeah, I'll work on the tile, put three or four variations on it, move on to the next tile, put three or four variations, it picks a random one and it spawns that version. And then do it, keep going on and on. As I was progressing halfway through them, so that's 45 to 60 tiles in total, sort of thing. And as I was progressing through them, constantly doing it and repeating it, trying to make them all different enough to not be repetitive. As you noticed, there were some repetitions there. But to try and make them not be repetitive got very tedious and very annoying, very boring and monotonous. And because of that, obviously it started slacking and cutting corners here and there. And then some of the middle ones looked better than the first one, so I'd go back and then try and do more and add more to them. And it was constantly doing the same thing over and over again. It wasn't even a massive variation of doing the same thing over again. So it wasn't like working on AI and then doing the level design and then doing the items as well and everything else. It was all just constantly putting things somewhere, making it spawn and not spawn. Putting things in there, making it spawn, not spawn, so on and so forth. By the last four or five tiles, I was struggling to maintain the progress. And I ended up just doing one variation on them. And to make them look different enough and have stuff happening there, the small and the large objects that are placed in the world would be randomized instead. And then I had to go back and redo that as well in the earlier ones, so that you'd have all the clutter and everything else, because it looked very empty. And no matter how much stuff was in there, it always looked empty, and it still looks a bit empty now. And it might be because you can't pick all those items up. One thing I did want to do was put the random items just in the overworld as well that you can pick up. That didn't want to work very well. Like, it wouldn't spawn the items correctly. It would spawn them without names, without any value or anything else. And I didn't really work out why, and I just ended up just scrapping that idea. It's like on the back burner, basically. I just scrapped it for now. But yeah, it would have helped to have someone else there to help with that level design, even if it's just adding assets into a randomizing array sort of thing, or doing one or two tiles here and there. That was probably the biggest hurdle that I had to overcome. But yeah, otherwise I'm quite happy with the result, to be honest. One of the things I did want to do was, when I initially started, I was thinking, oh, multiplayer would be great, and you could fight against each other, because again, that goes back to the inspiration of Clank, because that's a four-player game, or up to four players. The thought was to have multiple players and you can fight each other, and then the alarm goes off and then everyone gets chased, but not everyone has all the points, and then how far do you go and things like that, and it was going to be do stuff like that. But I decided to scrap that because obviously that would have taken a lot longer. I'm glad I did scrap that, because I wouldn't have had the time to do that at all. But yeah. Not sure what else there is to say. The random loot generation is also inspired by the Torchlight and Diablo, where they spawn the random items and random weapons and things. There's no combat. So you're relying on running away and stealth and things like that. There are places you can actually go under and hide from. You can go under some of the desks and the tables. You can go under some of the platforms as well. And you're hiding. So you're effectively basically a mouse or a rat, but you're a goblin. I don't sure if I've been repeating myself or going over now. I think that's about it. There is a chance that I will continue this. See how the paperwork goes. Thank you for watching. It's available on itch.io if anyone's interested in playing. Thank you. Link is in the description, I guess.